Our next speaker is Dr. Zachary Rubin. He is the medical director of the UCLA Clinical Epidemiology and Infection Prevention in the UCLA Health System, and is an associate professor of medicine in the Division of Infectious Diseases. He trained at Emory University and with the CDC, and he's going to talk about treatment of patients and management of potential contacts. Zach.
Thank you. Let's see if I can find my talk there. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about kind of the management of patients at UCLA. So that's kind of my area of expertise, since I'll talk mostly about UCLA. So obviously, just what Anna said, the best way to prevent infections in UCLA, in Los Angeles, and elsewhere is to prevent infections in Africa. So just want to say a group here. And let's just talk about what is going on in the United States now. Obviously, there's a fairly small number of infections in the United States, but they've obviously generated a lot of attention and caused a lot of anxiety. And as a result, healthcare centers, especially in large urban places in the United States, have been tasked to basically respond to potential Ebola cases. And so we've expended a lot of energy and resources to try to make sure that we're ready for Ebola. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we've kind of been doing. So I'm going to kind of skip through some of these things that were already covered, but just to give you one sense of what, at least the way we think about Los Angeles, is that you've got a number of different high-risk areas. One would be African nationals and visitors coming back to visit here in the United States. At least in Los Angeles, it's a fairly small number. And then returning healthcare workers and students coming from those areas, if they're helping out with the outbreak response, and that is a fairly small number as well, but that actually may be larger than the actual number in nationals. Symptoms of Ebola, kind of been mentioned a little bit, so let me skip that. And then clinical progression of disease. So progression of disease is important to understand. So the initial exposure happens, and 2 to 21 days after that, people will start to have symptoms of Ebola. People are not infectious until after they begin developing symptoms of Ebola. And I think that's something that the lay press has really kind of missed out on and doesn't understand. So the doctor in New York City, he was taking the subway the day before he was febrile or had fevers, really was not infectious to anybody else. And so that's kind of the line between panic and science, at least. And we're seeing that because even the patients who, people who came into contact with Mr. Duncan in Dallas, other than the two healthcare workers, have not had infections either with Ebola. So just routine kind of contact with patients, even after they're symptomatic of Ebola, as we've seen in the United States, has not resulted in any secondary cases. But it's important to note that it may be different in a healthcare center. So if you're dealing with people who are obviously very ill, the risk is that you could encounter transmissions if you're not careful, because you are dealing directly with people and their potential infections, infectious materials. So the treatment of Ebola is actually relatively straightforward. So for critical care doctors and infectious disease doctors who manage things like sepsis or septic shock, this is fairly similar. So patients tend to have a lot of fluid and electrolyte disturbances. So fluid and electrolyte management is really crucial and important, and has resulted in good fluid management and electrolyte management has resulted in significant improvements in outcomes when it's been applied, like in MSF and other hospital settings in Africa and also in the United States. Nutrition is important, antibiotics for bacterial superinfections, just giving people supplemental oxygen may be important, maintaining blood pressure, blood products, pain control, and then infection control as well. I'll talk a little bit more about that later. But infection control is crucially important, not to the patient themselves, but to decreasing the risk of transmission after healthcare workers come in contact with patients. And there are specific treatments for Ebola as well, but they haven't really been studied very well. So they've only been given really a relatively small handful of patients. But you've heard a lot about them on the news probably. ZMAP, which is a monoclonal antibody treatment. There's an antiviral drug that's being used as well. And then serum from recovered patients. So patients that have antibodies. And then prevention techniques. So there's some vaccines, candidate vaccines, that haven't really been tested all that well yet, but I think we're going to hear probably more about them going forward. So what makes Ebola difficult to manage? So as I said before, I mean, we do have a lot of sick patients in the hospital. with sepsis and similar problems to what I described with Ebola. So why is it so difficult to care patients in a U.S. hospital? Well, part of it is the risk of transmission, part of it is the fear of running away, but a lot of it is the requirement to make sure that our healthcare workers don't get infected through contact with patients. And that can be, that's a little bit different than the general population of patients we take care of. Obviously, the infectious fluids are all of them, blood, feces, urine, vomit, sweat, so they all have fairly high viral loads, so we have to be careful about all those things. But as was said before, just to make it clear, Ebola has not spread through the air, other than in aerosolized and small, small droplets, small distances after patients are undergoing procedures or some kind of a medical procedure. So it's not airborne, so we don't really need to worry about that issue. So what we found out is that successful Ebola management or response management really requires a big team of people at all levels of the healthcare setting. So not only infection prevention, but emergency preparedness, and everybody in the hospital really needs to step up to make sure that we're ready for this. And I'm proud to say that at UCLA, we've done that. So we have a working group of dozens of people, and then we have smaller working groups to actually deal with very specific issues. So I'll talk just about a couple of these. I'm not going to go over an entire response plan or anything, but just a few things. And just to keep in mind, kind of the Ebola preparedness at UCLA, the way we've been thinking about it is really based on three main pillars and then kind of some underlying issues that are important as well. So the first one is process, making sure that we have good patient care processes and that patients, from the time they hit the door to the hospital until the time they're discharged, that we're managing things in a very specific way, and we have processes to make sure that other healthcare workers don't get infected, that our patients are safe, that patients that don't have Ebola in the hospital are safe, and that we deliver the best possible care to the patients themselves. And that requires some specialized equipment, so personal protective gear that I'll show you. And it also requires a lot of training. And so just having the equipment on hand is really not enough. You have to actually train people to use it effectively, or it's really not useful. And then what we found is communication and education is really crucial because, especially over the last couple of weeks, there's been a huge amount of fear and anxiety, not only in the general public, but also among healthcare workers, about the potential for taking care of a patient with this. So we need to make sure that people understand the facts and are not swayed by conjecture. So Ebola preparedness in UCLA, just to give you a few specifics kind of in each area of processes. So we have to define clinical patient flow. It's not just that patients come in like a routine appendicitis and then are discharged. You have to take care of them in very specific ways. You have to define clinical care guidelines. So how do we do laboratories in these patients if we don't want blood to go down and contaminate the general clinical lab? Waste management, things like that. Routine medical procedures all become kind of more difficult. Equipment, so making sure we have the equipment on hand to deal with these things. So laboratory equipment, for instance, point of care testing. So we can do testing inside the patient room and we don't have to take any blood samples outside of that room. And then also things like personal protective equipment that we have personal protective equipment on hand all the time for other types of infections, but we don't have the gear that was really appropriate for Ebola, as we come to understand. And then training, the safe use of personal protective equipment is really crucial, and then making sure that we do drills and practice those things. So first of all, one thing is identifying the suspect case. And so one thing we've done is kind of modify the way we triage patients through emergency department. We make sure that we ask foreign travel history right up front and any additional symptoms. And if patients actually have potential symptoms or a travel history, then we would activate this whole cascade of responses. If a patient came to Santa Monica, we have a plan to transport the patient to Ronald Reagan for care, and that would be with a specialized ambulance and team to actually take care of it. And we've actually done drills to make sure that that works. And this is the whole cascade that actually happened. So it's not so simple. We have to kind of get together all the people that need to take care of this situation, and from environmental services and physicians and nurses, everybody has to kind of be ready and activated when we see a potential case. So we actually have an Ebola response team. I'll go through that. So there's a specific group of healthcare workers that are going to be specially trained to take care of patients. And personal protective equipment. So we've actually based a lot of the personal protective equipment on Emory University of Nebraska, Dr. Beth Porter, somebody showed, the one benefit I have is I did fellowship at Emory, so I've been able to talk with the people there and kind of get a sense of what they're doing. And so a lot of our response has been patterned after that. And so just to give you a sense of what it actually looks like, that's kind of what it looks like. Again, it's not airborne, but wearing a mask is fairly uncomfortable for any period of time, so we wear these masks that actually are much more comfortable for longer periods of time. And actually, personal protective equipment guidelines from CDC came out last week, and their recommendations are actually exactly what we were already doing pretty much. And just to give you a sense of what we've been doing, so we've been drilling, making sure that you know, the equipment is used correctly, so we've actually gone through a couple of drills. And this is the big one that we had a couple of Fridays ago, and it went very well. It was the first run, and we're working on a lot of things we've learned from that. So just to give you a sense, this is actually, I got this from the internet. This is, Ebola came to Kalamazoo, but it's funny because it's actually a picture of UCLA, so. Maybe they'll transport the patient to anyway, but that's basically all. So I'd like to thank you.